Part 9, Will Atmosphere. The individual in whom the will consciousness has been unfolded and manifested, he who has learned how to will is usually found to have unconsciously developed that peculiar aura, field of emanation, or whatever else it may be called, which is known to close students of the subject as the will atmosphere. The will atmosphere is like the field of induction of the strong magnet, the forces of which influence the particles of iron or steel within its limits. The will atmosphere of the will-conscious individual exerts a subtle but most powerful influence over those with whom he comes in contact. In some strange way, the other persons coming within the field of induction of such an individual instinctively recognize the power latent within his region of will, and they consciously or unconsciously adapt themselves to it. We wish here to illustrate this principle of will atmosphere by citing several celebrated cases in which the force in question has been manifested in a striking manner. For some of these illustrations, we are indebted to Dr. J. Milner Fothergill, who, a number of years ago, gathered together many instances and examples of will power and included them in a work upon the subject, which we believe to be now out of print. First of all, we shall ask you to consider that striking illustration given by Oliver Wendell Holmes, which Fothergill prefaces with the following comment: "The steady conflict of the eye is familiar to many of us. The boy looks at his mother to see if she is in earnest in her threat. When older, he likewise looks at his schoolmaster to read his purpose. Two men or a woman look at each other steadily. No word is said. The conflict is soon over, and one walks ahead of the other ever after." The instance related by Holmes is stated by him as follows: "The Koh-i-Noor's face turned so white with rage that his blue-black mustache and beard looked fearful seen against it. He grinned with wrath, and caught at a tumbler, as if he would have thrown its contents at the speaker. The young Marylander fixed his clear steady eye upon him, and laid his hand on his arm, carelessly almost, but the jewel felt it was held so that he could not move it. It was no use. The youth was his master in muscle, and in that deadly Indian hug in which men wrestle with their eyes, over in 5 seconds, but breaks one of their two backs, and is good for 80 years and 10. One trial enough, it settles the whole matter, just as when two feathered songsters of the barnyard, Game and Dunghill, come together, after a jump or two at each other, and a few sharp kicks, there is an end of it, and it is aperçu, monsieur, with the beaten party in all the social relations for all the rest of his days." Fothergill relates with relish the celebrated instance of the meeting of Hugo, Bishop of Lincoln, and Richard Coeur de Lion, in the church of Rochdandely. In this case, Richard, being involved in war with Normandy, demanded more supplies of his barons. The Bishop of Lincoln refused to supply any men, holding that the See of Lincoln was bound to military service only when a war was waged within the four seas of Britain. Richard, a man of very strong will, was incensed by the refusal of the bishop, and summoned the latter to Normandy. When the bishop reached Normandy, he found that the king was furiously enraged with him. Mutual friends advised him to send a conciliatory message to the king before venturing to enter his presence. But the bishop declined the advice, and preferred to trust to his own sense of awakened will consciousness. The king was sitting at mass when the prelate walked up to him and, despite the monarch's frown, said, "Kiss me, my lord king." The king turned away his face. Hugo shook him, and repeated his request. "Thou hast not deserved it," growled the king fiercely. "I have," returned the undaunted prelate, shaking the king by the shoulder even still harder. The king yielded. The kiss was given and the bishop passed calmly on to take part in the service. Fothergill adds, "Mere indifference to death could never have produced such a result. There was something more. As well as being utterly fearless, Bishop Hugo possessed a will, a power of most unusual character, of which several instances are on record. Not only did he face the king and justify his refusal to supply men in the council chamber afterwards, he went further, and rebuked the king for infidelity to his queen. The lion was tamed for the moment. The king acknowledged nothing, but restrained his passion, observing afterwards, "If all bishops were like my lord of Lincoln, not a prince among us could lift his head against them." Such is the story as told by Froude. Yet Richard was the last man to permit a liberty to be taken with him, as his whole history showed. This, however, was not the only instance in the career of Hugo in which he shows that his will power was capable of dominating that of his king. An earlier king, Henry Plantagenet, who, indeed, had made Hugo the Bishop of Lincoln in the first place, went down in defeat before the bishop's sole power, as truly as did his successor. King Henry preferred a request for a favor to be bestowed by the bishop upon a certain courtier. His request was bluntly refused. Hugo had already braved the wrath of the king, and the monarch was very angry at him. Henry was with his suite in Woodstock Park, and sat down on the ground pretending to be mending his leather glove when the bishop approached him. The king took no notice of his spiritual peer. After a brief pause, Hugo, pushing aside an earl, sat down by the king's side. Watching the royal proceedings, he remarked, "Your Majesty reminds me of your cousins at Falaise." Falaise was a place famous for its leather works, and it was there that Duke Robert met Arlotta, the tanner's daughter, the mother of William the Conqueror, King Henry's ancestor. The reference to his humble ancestry was too much for the king, who was badly worsted in the discussion which followed. Father Gill says, "A similar character is presented to us in General Gordon. It was not his absolute indifference about his life which gained him his ascendancy. In China, where life is held to be of little or no moment, the absence of any fear of death would go but little way, and it did not constitute the basis of Chinese Gordon's ascendancy. His secretly elsewhere. Nor did his supremacy in the Sudan rest upon his bravery, for the Arabs of the Sudan are as brave as any warriors in the world, as the history of their conflicts testify." When Gordon took a chair and sate himself down by King John of Abyssinia, or presented himself alone to the Arab Sikhs who had sworn to take his life, it was not his disdain of death alone which carried him through both barrels unharmed, or enabled him to hold Khartoum. Equally implicit confidence in the protection of heaven has not saved others when in peril. All the faith of Savonarola only led him to a horrible death amidst torturing flames. But without this indifference to their fate, neither Bishop Hugo nor General Gordon could have come unscathed out of the terrible dangers they deliberately chose to meet. Any fear of death certainly would emasculate any man under these circumstances. The will of atmospheral power must be accompanied by personal courage when danger to life has to be encountered. The heroism of the Jesuits, who labored among the Red Indians early in the history of Canada, was sustained by their devotion, for many suffered terrible cruelties. But no one of them ever possessed in a higher degree that willpower which compels the obedience of others than did La Salle, the pioneer of the Mississippi. In George Washington we see a splendid illustration of that power which molds other men, and compels them to follow its behests. His patient sagacity rested on the basis of his willpower. A curious instance of the magnetic power of will was furnished by the story of the relations of the late Benjamin Disraeli to the Conservative Party of England. An alien, handicapped by his early avocations, at first the House refused to listen to him. Yet irresistibly he rose step by step to be a Conservative leader who educated his party and at last was Prime Minister with a solid array of the best bred Normanna-descended patricians of England at his back, yielding ready obedience to his wish as a leader of men. Men, too, deeply imbued with traditions and also a personal friend of his sovereign. Hear what is meant by the words, "A by faith ye shall move mountains," was illustrated vividly. The House of Orange has furnished some striking examples of the effect of willpower. William the Silent held his followers together by an iron will that bent under no catastrophe, no disaster. It refused to submit. A like character was that of William, afterward King of England. Men who disliked him did his bidding. He inspired the dispirited allies with his own resoluteness. When his schemes were foiled by a defeat, he immediately set to work to repair his losses, and deprive the French of the fruit of their victory. That the House of Orange possessed many grand characteristics will be readily admitted, but no one of their endowments is more remarkable than their willpower. The peculiar commanding power of leaders, no matter whether regular like John Churchill or that of a guerrilla chief like Mina, in the Peninsula War of Spain of the Red Indian Pontiac, who imperiled the existence of the Anglo-Saxons on the American continent, or even the Negro commander Toussaint Louverture, seems not to depend willpower upon ability only, but on character, in which the willpower is a leading factor. Men with marked willpower come to the front in emergencies, as seen in Oliver Cromwell, the Fingrazier, and Napoleon Bonaparte, the artillery subaltern. In both these instances national convulsions produced the seething cauldron from whence they rose each to an eminence of position and fame. They were heavily handicapped by their early position, yet they rose superior to it. But amidst all these men there rises up a woman even more remarkable than they, the village maiden Joan of Arc, who inspired courage into the beaten warriors of France, and led them to victory. In what lay her witchcraft, for which she was finally burnt? In her capacity to animate others, which was really based on her willpower. The case of Disraeli, mentioned above by Father Gill, is a typical instance of the possession of that something combined willpower and will atmosphere which distinguishes individuals in whom the will consciousness has been awakened and developed. When he first arose to speak in the House of Commons, he was jeered and derided. The House would have none of him. Upon this occasion he hurled at his opponents that remarkable prophecy, "I have begun several times many things, and I have often succeeded at last. And though I may sit down now, the time will come when you will hear me." And that time did come, and before long, too. Father Gill says of this, "The time came, sure enough, when the House not only listened to him, but even acknowledged his mastery over it." Disraeli had learned, what many another man learns, that because he failed at first it does not follow that ultimate success is unattainable. The baffled speaker eventually came to hold the House spellbound with his barbed shafts of rhetoric. He soon attacked fiercely Sir Robert Peel, who was an excellent speaker, and the pungency of his remarks taught the House to dread him, the one at whom they once had scoffed. It must have needed great resolution to face the House of Commons again after that first terrible rebuff, but after the attempt had once been made, the rest was comparatively easy. Disraeli's subsequent career furnishes one of the most striking examples of the power of the individual to overcome apparently insurmountable obstacles by sheer force of willpower. Step by step he advanced in face of opposition sufficient to have dismayed any ordinary man. At last, he, Disraeli the Jew, became Prime Minister of England and the actual ruler of the destinies of a great part of the world. This man has thrilled the souls of several later generations of courageous and ambitious men, not only by the force of his example, but also by those remarkable words of his which we have already quoted in this book, but which we wish here to impress still more forcibly upon your memory. "I have brought myself by long meditation to the conviction that a human being with a settled purpose must accomplish it, and that nothing can resist a will which will stake even existence itself upon its fulfillment." Not only the history of warfare, and that of statesmanship, are filled with recitals of instances in which will power, will consciousness, will atmosphere have won the day. The history of business likewise is rich in instances and examples of this kind. A study of the life histories of the great captains of industry, of the men who have arrived in the various fields of business life, will convince any unprejudiced reader that there exists a something which exerts its forces and energies in favor of the individual possessing it. A still closer analysis will reveal the fact that that something has willpower at the very heart and center of itself, is possessed of the will consciousness, and manifests the will atmosphere. Father Gill gives us many typical instances of this kind which he noted in his study of the history of English manufacturers. We shall give you in brief form a statement of several of the most typical of these cases cited by him. A study of these and similar cases serves to awaken the perhaps dormant willpower in the reader, and also illustrates the general principle now under consideration by us. Josiah Wedgwood was the youngest of 14 children, bred and born a potter. At that time the pottery business of England was limited to a very common earthenware. The fine pottery now produced is largely the result of the pioneer work performed by this only at time little delicate lad. He was apprenticed to the trade, but was handicapped by illness which made him lame in his right knee, and which finally resulted in the amputation of his right leg. Crippled as he was, he worked away. Gladstone afterwards said of him that his physical disability sent his mind in words, and drove him to meditate upon the laws and secrets of his art. By adding silica to the day, he succeeded in making a white ware instead of the dirt-colored products hitherto made. Then he began to experiment along the lines of perfecting his glazes. Then he had to erect his furnaces. Then came the art taste. He paid large sums for old examples of art ware, and copied these accurately. Then he rediscovered the lost art of painting on biscuit ware practiced by the old Etruscans, and then employed Flaxman as his artist. He worked for the throne and became the royal potter. He not only advanced himself, but also made of his part of England a great higher-grade pottery-producing center. Wedgwood furnishes a typical example of the man handicapped by nature, facing great obstacles, meeting with many discouragements, but in the end triumphing by means of the consistent application of his willpower. In him the will consciousness had been awakened, he had the will atmosphere highly developed, according to the testimony of those of his own times. The story of Lister and silk waste also furnishes an illustration of the general principle under consideration. Lister's attention was directed to what was known as silk waste, i.e., the waste made from the manufacture of neat silk and pierced cocoons, and which looked like mutilated ropes, dirty flax, or mucilaginous hemp, and was knotted and sticky and choked with sticks and leaves and dead silkworms. For many years he struggled with the problem of converting this unpromising waste stuff into available silk material. He battled with circumstances, and repeatedly faced utter financial ruin in the attempt. At one time he was out of pocket no less a sum than $1,500,000, the fortune previously made by him in other ventures. His indomitable will, his unflagging energy, his persistent endeavors, alone carried him through and converted defeat into victory. In the end, he succeeded in manufacturing silk velvets, velvets with a silk bile and cotton back, silk carpets, imitation sealskin, plush velvet ribbons, corded ribbons, sewing silks, Japanese silks, poplins, etc., from the once despised silk waste. When, in after years, a statue to Lister was unveiled at Bradford, England, an eminent speaker said, "What is it especially we are honoring? It is the pluck which this man has shown. It is the feeling that he said to himself, 'Ay, here is something which ought to be done. I will not rest until I have found out how it can be done.' And having found out how it can be done, where is the man who will stop me doing it?" A writer, in relating the story of Josiah Mason, the English manufacturer who started in business at the age of 8 years, peddling cakes on the street, and who when he died was one of Great Britain's great commercial giants, says of the subject of his sketch, "Mason had, to begin with, a strong, powerful, almost irresistible will. That which he wanted, he would have, and in a great measure he did have. Little or great, all objects or purposes came within the range of his powerful will. And whatever or whoever he opposed, he surely conquered in the end." Not that he was blindly obstinate, or unwilling to take counsel. Another great quality which he possessed, very helpful to the accomplishment of his will, was absolute patience. He knew how to wait. With patience there went in close union a wonderful perseverance. Mason was remarkably tenacious. He held firm to his purpose, and worked it out with never ceasing vigilance and energy. He was the embodiment of living willpower. Illustrations and examples of this kind might be multiplied indefinitely. The story is the same, no matter of whom it is told, or what may be the native land of that person. It becomes certain to the student of the subject that some great, general, universal principle is back of and under these manifold instances. There is always evident the presence and power of that something which is manifesting as will power, will consciousness, will atmosphere. The matter is raised out of the category of mere coincidence by the overwhelming number of the cases in which the principle is found operating. It is seen to be the result of an invariable process of cause and effect, of the law of causation operating on the plane of mentality. We believe that the principles and methods which we have set forth in the pages of the present book will serve to point out to the earnest, persistent, courageous individual the road which must be traveled by him in his journey toward attainment by willpower. We believe that in the statement of the master formula is to be found the secret of success. Let us repeat it to you once more in its popular form. Here it is: you may have anything you want, provided that you, 1, know exactly what you want, 2, want it hard enough, 3, confidently expect to obtain it, 4, persistently determine to attain it, and 5, are willing to pay the price of its attainment. Reread the several instances of success through willpower related in the foregoing pages of this section, and consider them in the light of the master formula of attainment above stated. You will see that in each and every case the successful individual has, first, known exactly what he wanted to do or to get, that he has then wanted it hard enough that he has firmly believed in and confidently expected to get or to do it, that he has persistently determined to get or to do it, and, finally, that he has always been willing to pay the price of the attainment or achievement. In each case there has been that marked manifestation of, 1, ideals, 2, desire, 3, faith, 4, will, and, 5, service. Let us close by quoting the following truths from the writing of Dr. Fothergill, that esteemed pioneer in the work of recording the principles and practice of willpower, and whose work has served as at least a part of the foundation structure of all who have followed him. He says, "Willpower is seen in the man who bides his time, who knows how to wait," which involves the A1 and the AY. Circumstances may stand in his way, and he must wait, but the will is neither bent, broken, nor warped by that fact, and is all along as assertive as ever, even when apparently in abeyance. Yet willpower is not mere perseverance, it is something more. It is an entity in itself. Finis.